A lot of people on the internet have been telling me to drink raw milk. It is the internet. There are a lot of bad ideas out there. But this one makes me particularly angry because it is a terrible idea. So I wanted to make a video about why it is such a bad idea, but then I realized I've actually been eating a form of raw milk without even knowing it. So then the video got a little bit more complicated. So let's start with the big question. Do you really need to pasteurize milk?
Yes. Yes, oh my gosh, yes, please drink pasteurized milk, not raw milk. Sure, there are minute chemical compositional changes that happen during pasteurization, and I will explain, but those are not worth the risk of drinking it raw. What risk? Things like listeria, salmonella, diphtheria, tuberculosis, bird flu, you know, the usual stuff you get eating food. Yeah, you might lose a tiny bit of vitamin B12 in your pasteurized milk, but you are not going to die. Pasteurization is an incredible chemistry win in the world of food safety. By heating raw milk to at least 161 Fahrenheit for 15 seconds and letting it cool, we can reduce the amount of viruses and bacteria in dairy. But what if you turn that raw milk into cheese? Is that safe? Our long history and culture of cheesemaking means that you may have eaten raw milk cheese before without even knowing it, and you're still here watching this video. So what's the chemistry there, and is it worth the risk to eat a delicious Parmesan? I'm gonna piss off like half of Europe in this video, aren't I? This is raw milk, and this is pasteurized milk. They look nearly indistinguishable. And despite what other parts of the internet may tell you, drinking both of them will likely give me the same exact lactose-induced stomach ache. But one of them could also potentially give me tuberculosis. Milk's biochemical purpose is to support life, and it does not discriminate. The same contents that give milk everything that a growing calf needs are what make it an incredible breeding ground for bacteria, yeast, and mold.
So there are different types of pasteurization based mainly on what equipment is available to you and how much money you're willing to spend, and a little bit about the fat content of the milk. So there's high temperature short time, which heats milk to 161 Fahrenheit for 15 seconds. There's low temperature long time, which is 145 degrees Fahrenheit for 30 minutes. And then there's ultra high temperature, which heats it to 280 to 300 degrees Fahrenheit for like 2 to 6 seconds. So different things depending on kind of what you're looking for and how much money you want to spend. Low temperature, long time is really the only one that makes sense to do in my kitchen. So here's what we're gonna do. I bought some raw milk, which inexplicably California allows me to buy. I've sterilized some mason jars. I put raw milk into half the jars and the other half I pasteurized before putting into sterile containers. I'll leave one pasteurized and one unpasteurized out of my counter and do the same for two jars that I'm gonna put in the fridge. It's been like 5 or 6 days and both of these look pretty gross right now, but the raw milk one started to separate around day 2. The pasteurized one took a little bit more to day 3 or day 4. Both of them now though are pretty chunky. Yeah, my like raw milk fridge one is not great. My pasteurized fridge one is also not great. They all got a little funky after like a week. The half of the milk that I pasteurized, I did in a double boiler on the stove. I tried to keep it between 145 degrees Fahrenheit and 160 degrees Fahrenheit for 30 minutes. This was a little hard to do without cooking the milk. The idea is that we want to heat the raw milk high enough and hold it at that temperature for a set amount of time to inactivate all of the vegetative bacteria, or the bacteria that's currently undergoing metabolism and reproducing, inside that milk so that they can't proliferate anymore. But we don't want it to be so high that we cook the milk. This is my bacteria. I never claimed to be an artist. So to inactivate the bacteria, we actually don't need to break it apart into 1,000 pieces. We just have to shut down a critical component or a couple of critical components that the bacteria need to survive. Now, it's not clear if there's one particular system that is shut down more often or fastest by heat, but scientists typically think that heat is affecting multiple components that the bacteria need to live, including ribosomes, RNA polymerase, and the cellular membrane. Now, ribosomes are the proteins that cells use to make more proteins, so they're pretty easy to talk about here. By heating them up, you can start to denature them, breaking bonds between their amino acids and changing their shape. This means that they can't translate RNA into protein anymore, and if we shut off a cell's ability to make more proteins, it's gonna die. Or it's at least gonna stop replicating. And it's not just bacteria. Viruses can hang out in raw milk too, things like avian influenza, aka bird flu, which has been found in multiple herds of cows around the US. Not only that, but there have so far been at least 3 cases of bird flu in humans in the US this year, all of them in dairy workers working with infected cows. But recent work from the FDA found that pasteurization can inactivate the virus in milk, and inactivated viral particles have been found in pasteurized commercial milk from multiple states, but none of it contained active virus because
pasteurization likely inactivated it. But what does pasteurization do to the milk? Cow's milk contains water, proteins, sugars like lactose, lipids and minerals, and vitamins like riboflavin and phosphorus and B12, etc., etc., etc. It does a body good, you know the drill. It's technically an emulsion of oil in water, with fatty droplets suspended in water.
All of those proteins and lipids and minerals and good stuff mean that it is an incredibly flexible food product.
Milk proteins are split into two main categories, casein and whey. Casein is a family of related insoluble proteins that in milk often exists in a colloidal supermolecule called a casein micelle. Basically, they stick together in little hydrophobic clumps. Casein is the main protein in most cheeses too that gives them their structure. Whey is also a family of proteins, this time soluble proteins, and we typically hear about them as the byproduct of cheese making. There's a bunch of stuff in whey. Alpha-lactalbumin, beta-lactoglobulin, immunoglobulins, soluble protein stuff. When we pasteurize milk, we're also exposing the casein and the whey to heat that could denature them. Studies show that heating milk at high temperatures for long periods of time denatures whey proteins so that they can not only react with each other, but also with casein, creating bigger globules of proteins. But what happens at pasteurization temperatures and times? A really nice study out of Brazil looked at side-by-side samples of raw, pasteurized, and sterilized or ultra-high temperature treated milk from a dairy factory in Brazil. They looked at all kinds of potential changes in the milk, from moisture content to lactose content to calcium and other mineral and vitamin content, pH measures, fatty acid profile, you get the picture. They found that protein, lactose, calcium, and phosphorus content stayed similar in the heat-treated milks. Homogenization and heat treatment seemed to disrupt the membrane of the fat globules, but overall fatty acid profiles stayed relatively unchanged. The pH was slightly increased, which reduced the amount of whey proteins associated with the casein micelles, but overall these changes were small, really small. One of the biggest changes after pasteurization was the decrease in total bacterial count.
Again, please don't drink raw milk. It is not worth it.
But there are some cheeses that are made with raw milk. And by the way, there are so many kinds of cheeses in the world, I'm going to have to generalize a little bit in some areas, so I apologize if I've left out your favorite Epoire or Mimolette. Mimolette? I don't even know.
Mimolette.
The short version of cheese making is turn warm milk into a lump of solid or solidish protein and fat, first by adding acid, either from acid-producing bacteria or a mixture of enzymes called rennet, or things like lemon juice or citric acid for us home DIYers. You can insert footage of me making mozzarella here. Turned out okay. This causes casein proteins to denature and start to clump together. You can add more enzymes to further precipitate and break down the proteins, then remove the remaining whey liquid, and then you could either heat it more or add mold spores or shape it or let it age depending on the flavor that you want. Now, during my research into pasteurization, I went down like a cheese pull rabbit hole and I wanted to figure out how to make the best cheese pull, and it turns out that pH is involved, so then I went out and I bought this like cheese pH meter, and that's gonna be just really useful in my kitchen all the time. I'm just gonna test cheese pHs daily. New hobby. pH of a cheese can have big impacts on its texture. The casein mesh that forms in the cheese making process is held together in part by calcium ions that allow it some give, gives a little stretch. But the calcium can dissociate from the proteins if the acid level is too high. So low acid cheeses like feta and goat cheese have lots of calcium gluing the casein together and they break really easily and they won't stretch. But if the cheese has a higher acid content, like a Gruyere or a blue cheese, the casein proteins can come apart too much and won't stretch well either. You need a moderate acid cheese for a good cheese pull. Now, during cheese aging, the breakdown of fats in a process called lipolysis can help give cheeses their distinctive flavors. Enzymes in the milk break down long fatty acids, releasing free fatty acids that give cheeses their distinctive flavors. For example, butyric acid, a very short fatty acid, is a common one, and has a baby vomit or rancid scent distinctive of cheeses like provolone and feta. I didn't come up with those descriptors. But these free fatty acids can also produce buttery flavors, fruity flavors, all the good flavors that you want in cheese. Lactose and proteins are also broken down in the ripening process, and the resulting smaller sugars and amino acids can also carry their own flavors. So, does making cheese out of raw milk have any impact on this process, and how do the proteins and lipids turn into something delicious? The raw milk might have an impact on flavor. Cheese connoisseurs often say that raw milk cheeses have more intense, stronger flavors, potentially due to higher levels of things like carboxylic acids, esters, and alcohols that come from fermentation of the milk by the microbiome of the raw milk. But here's the thing. Raw milk cheeses often have a high moisture content, a low acidity, and are aged at warmer temperatures, meaning that potentially pathogenic bacteria could thrive in the cozy, warm cheese. Here in the US, the FDA therefore stipulates that raw milk cheeses have to be aged for at least 60 days before being sold, with the idea that at this point the cheeses would be too dry or acidic or salty for bacteria to thrive, giving time for all of that bad bacteria to die out before you eat it. Again, if you suck all the water out of cells through evaporation or salt, or denature their proteins with acid, they're not going to be so good at making you sick anymore. This makes a lot of sense for something like a raw milk cheddar, which gets hard and salty and inhospitable. But it makes a little less sense for a camembert, which keeps a pretty low acid and high moisture level. Studies have shown that the levels of pathogenic bacteria do decrease in these kinds of cheese over time, but it doesn't always work. And low levels of things like E. coli, 0157H7, and mycobacteria can still exist. And in fact, just this year in 2024, there was an outbreak of E. coli linked to raw milk cheddar sold in the US. This is why some producers are arguing against the 60-day rule and for an approach that instead tests the cheese for pathogenic bacteria at multiple steps along the production pathway. And this should probably apply to all cheeses. Pasteurized milk cheeses can become contaminated during their production too, due to the fact that, again, you are letting a hunk of perfect microbial food sit around for a while before you eat it. A CDC study looking at cheese-related disease outbreaks between 1998 and 2011 found that of the 90 outbreaks, 42% happened in raw milk cheeses and 49% happened in pasteurized milk cheeses. So, should you swear off all raw milk cheeses because of the potential for contamination? Honestly, I thought that I had until I looked in my fridge and realized that a lot of the Parmesan and other cheeses I buy all the time are made with raw milk. They're actually pretty common. If aged properly, the risks of raw milk cheeses aren't zero, but they're low. If you're out here eating things like oysters, which contribute to about 80,000 vibriosis cases per year, you're potentially at a higher risk of food poisoning from those than from raw milk cheese. But not raw milk. That is a much, much higher risk. And just to really emphasize this point, in 1938, dairy was connected to 25% of disease outbreaks due to contaminated water and food. 25%. Now, that figure is down to 1%. Pasteurization saves lives and stops the spread of preventable diseases and does not meaningfully change the nutritional value of the milk. Stop it with the raw milk. Stop it. Stop.